Gentlemen, start your engines!
This video, He Drove What, is our seventh video highlighting different instances of NASCAR drivers needing relief help. We tell the stories about relief drivers hopping behind the wheel to help out an injured or a sick driver, with many of the stories falling through the cracks in NASCAR history, as the race is of course always credited to the driver who started the event and not the one who helped out. Once you're done watching this video, make sure to check out He Drove What Parts 1 through 6, which are on our channel. And now, for our feature presentation. Winston Cup Series points leader Rusty Wallace was involved in a horrifying practice crash at Bristol in 1988 during practice for the Busch 500. His number 27 car hit the wall, turned over, and barrel rolled multiple times before it came to a stop on its wheels. It took the track rescue workers almost 15 minutes to remove Wallace from the car. ESPN's Dr. Jerry Punch was one of the people who arrived at the wreckage to help Wallace, and he turned out to be a hero. Punch recently talked about the incident on the incredible Dale Jr. Download. He said he was luckily a few feet away from where the number 27 car came to a rest following the crash, and he quickly jumped over the pit wall to see if he could be of any assistance. The crash destroyed the roof of the car and made it impossible to take the window net down. Punch could see Wallace through the wreckage, and it looked about as bad as it could be. Wallace, who was wearing an open-faced helmet, had blood coming out of his mouth and was slumped over and unconscious. Punch worked to try to get his airway open as the track crew worked to take off the roof of the number 27 car. By the time they finally got him out of the car, he was still not breathing, but soon thereafter, he started to breathe on his own. It turned out that Wallace had ate an entire ham sandwich before practice, and the crash lodged the sandwich in his throat, which blocked his ability to breathe. In Wallace's Hall of Fame speech in 2013, he talked about an incredible conversation Richard Petty had with Wallace before the practice crash.
But the problem started kind of before I got in the car. Dale Emna, you know where I'm going with this story, don't you? I was there and I grabbed a ham sandwich. I made it up real quick and I wolfed that baby down and I took that. Richard Petty comes over to me. Richard says, "Hey kid, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm having a sandwich, King." And he goes, "You can't do that before you go practice." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Don't you know any smart race car driver knows you can't have a sandwich and jump right on up the racetrack and go practice. If you wreck, that thing could get clogged up in your esophagus and you could choke and die."
Wallace's team pulled a show car out of their hauler after the crash and began prepping it for the event. That car had not competed in a race in over 6 months. Wallace actually sent over notes from the hospital to his crew on how to set up the car to his liking, anticipating he would be ready for the event. He eventually returned to the track and qualified the car 17th the next day. Wallace did have plans to go the entire 500 miles, but he said before the race if the race turned out to be full of long runs that he would have to hand his steering wheel over to defending Busch Grand National Series champion Larry Pearson, who is the son of former Winston Cup star David Pearson. Once the race started, Wallace eventually radioed to his crew while he was running ninth that his neck was starting to get a little stiff and that he was ready to utilize Pearson. Wallace originally wanted to go as long as he could because he said Pearson is used to driving the Busch Grand National Series races, which are about 200 laps. The team tried to milk it on the track as long as they could in hopes of catching a caution, and it worked out for them as a hard crash involving Mark Martin, Dale Jarrett, and Davey Allison brought the caution flag out with just about 300 laps to go. Pearson, who had won the previous night's Busch Series Tri-City Pontiac 200, hopped in the number 27 car under caution. Wallace sped up the process, unbuckling as he came down pit road and helped Pearson get buckled in the car. Dr. Punch, who was serving as the pit reporter for the driver change, immediately switched roles and started describing to the viewers on how he was going to help Wallace after he climbed from the car. A few minutes later, after being checked out, Wallace talked about his incredibly tough performance.
"The neck, it's just, I couldn't hold up no more. I pulled the neck strap down as hard as I could, pulled the seat belt down as hard as I could, and it just kept putting a god-awful strain on it, and I figured, why screw it up now when I got a good driver like Larry who can take over for me?"
Pearson did exactly what the team asked of him, keeping the car in contention and brought the number 27 car home in ninth place. Bill Elliott, who was battling Wallace for the Winston Cup, led three laps and finished second. This moved Elliott into first in the Winston Cup Series point standings, moving Wallace to second, 16 points back with 9 races remaining. Wallace went on to finish second in the final season standings, 24 points back of Elliott. Fast forward to 2 years later at Bristol for the running of the Busch 500 under the lights, and we saw a few more instances of relief drivers being needed during the event. Rookie driver Rob Moroso had a tough night, spinning on lap 121 and backing into the wall on lap 192, ending his day early. Right before the incident, John Kernan said that Richard Petty was struggling with the heat and needed a relief driver in the number 43. The team wanted Chad Little to hop in, but they couldn't find him, so they were trying to work out a deal to get Moroso out of his number 20 car and into the number 43. Less than 30 laps later, the caution came out for a crash involving Morgan Shepherd. Davey Allison brought his number 28 car into the pits with Moroso on the pit wall looking ready to get into that car. Allison took his car back onto the track to stay on the lead lap, but brought it back down pit road the following lap as Moroso hopped into the number 28. Moroso made a handful of laps in the car before contact from Bobby Hillen Jr. sent him around and into the inside wall. A few laps later, Richard Petty brought his number 43 car behind the wall and retired for the day with no relief help. Chad Little, who was rumored earlier to take over for Petty, hopped in the number 26 for Brett Bodine, who was experiencing leg cramps. Little soon spun the car and backed it into the wall on lap 399. Petty's son Kyle was having trouble with burns on his foot from the intense heat. It was only a few laps later when the number 42 hit the wall, Kyle bumped his head, and was left feeling woozy. Who got in the number 42 for Kyle as the team tried to fix the car and send it back onto the track? None other than his dad, Richard himself. After the game of musical seats was over with, Rob Moroso brought the number 28 home in 23rd place. Chad Little was 25th in the number 26 car, the 28th for the number 42 of Kyle Petty, and 29th number 43. A hard crash during the 1996 Die Hard 500 at Talladega left Dale Earnhardt battered and bruised as the seven-time champion fractured his left collarbone and sternum. He originally was not sure if he would qualify his car for the upcoming Brickyard 400, but was hopeful following some work with Dr. Terry Trammell. He has some little tricks he can use on the skin and on the areas that are hurt and maybe relieve the pain while I'm driving and help with the seatbelts and shoulder harness, Earnhardt said. Defending Craftsman Truck Series champion Mike Skinner, who was the driver of the number 3 Goodwrench truck for Richard Childress, practiced the car Wednesday at Indianapolis. Earnhardt would practice himself and qualify his car 12th on Friday, as Skinner was at Indianapolis Raceway Park for the Truck Series event, a race that Skinner started on the pole, led all 200 laps, and won. Although Skinner was more than a viable candidate to drive the famed number 3 car, he wasn't the first choice. We talked to Roger Penske and Al Unser Jr. about possibly driving the car for us, Earnhardt said. He really wanted to do it. But again, he's in a points race too, and he had a test scheduled for Saturday, so he said to us, "Can I have a rain check?" Before the race, Skinner was interviewed on pit road by Dr. Jerry Punch and talked about his role as a relief driver for the race.
Well, the first three quarters of the race, we need to collect points. We need to be there at the end, whether we're last place or, you know, 20th or whatever. We're going to go out and try to ride, run consistent laps, and keep the car out of trouble. If the car's capable of winning toward the end of the race, we're going to run it hard as we can. We're just going to have to cross that bridge when we come to it.
Early on in the race, Robert Presley spun and brought out the first caution of the day. This was a blessing for the number 3 team as Earnhardt immediately wasted no time and brought the car down pit road. "Tell Skinner he's going to have a fine ride," Earnhardt said over the radio as he came to his pit. The crew was glad that Earnhardt had decided to get out of his car with his injuries because they said he stayed up all night long before the race watching Clint Eastwood movies trying to talk himself into toughing his way through the entire race. Earnhardt climbed out of his car to a roaring ovation out of respect from the crowd. Earnhardt was visibly upset that he had to get out of the car, waving off an interview from Jerry Punch as he gathered himself for a few seconds. Punch went back to Earnhardt a few seconds later, and the short interview spoke a thousand words about Earnhardt's emotions on the day's events.
Champ, did the car feel okay to you out there?
Yeah.
Okay, you can see the disappointment on his face.
About 20 minutes later, though, Earnhardt got back with Punch, and he talked about how he wasn't in that much pain, but he followed the plan and got out of the car to ensure he wasn't injured more in case anything else happened that day.
Dadgum, it's hard to get out of there, Jerry. It's my life right here.
Boy, an emotional deal, Earnhardt. You will never see that. This man loves and lives to race.
Skinner had a solid day in the number 3 car and finished 15th. That helped Earnhardt stay close in the battle for the Winston Cup Championship, leaving second in points only 61 behind Terry Labonte. The 2000 Pennsylvania 500 at Pocono Raceway saw another champion have to climb out of his car during a race for relief help. The previous weekend at Loudon, which was one full of emotions after the tragic passing of Kenny Irwin Jr., Labonte slammed into the wall in lap 5 as his car burst into flames before coming to a rest on the track. Labonte, who was already battling a fractured shin and a concussion that he suffered in a crash at Daytona, limped away from his battered car as his Kellogg's crew came to his rescue. Labonte's tough stretch led him to tabbing Rich Bickle to be on standby for the number 5 car at Pocono. An early caution on lap 26 let Labonte bring his car down pit road for service and also allowed Bickle to hop in the car to relieve the driver. It was honestly a rare sight to see the Iceman not racing, as he was in the midst of a streak of a record 655 consecutive Winston Cup starts. The race at Pocono turned out to be the final race of the incredible streak, as he sat out the following week at Indianapolis and the next week at Watkins Glen, despite attempting to practice the car at Indianapolis before realizing it was better if he just rested. Bickle had an incredible day in the number 5 Chevrolet, coming home with an 11th place finish. That would have been tied for the 4th best finish of his Winston Cup Series career if the finish had not been credited to the ailing Labonte. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video. As always, please make sure to hit the subscribe button to be the first to know when we post more new content just like this.